This is 10's late news with all the news you need tonight.
They come and it'll suck you out. Get out of here.
Millions feel Milton's mayhem as the mega storm barrels through Florida. The cleanup now underway. Israel's war cabinet is just hours away from rubber stamping retaliation against Iran, the ominous warning from their defense minister. The king of clay, Rafael Nadal, has just made a major announcement about his future. The deputy PM's left offending allegations his chief of staff was bullied out of her job. A senior Air Force pilot is charged with murder over a mysterious lawnmower death. Don't take us for mugs, the warning from the treasurer as unrest in the Middle East pumps up petrol prices. Three dogs shot dead and a woman fighting for her life in Melbourne. New details emerge of a fateful helicopter joyride in North Queensland. The Aussie tracked down by New Zealand's defence minister for misogynistic comments. And should you be fined for leaving your bin out too long? The local council saying yes.
Welcome to 10's Late News with Ursula Hayden.
First tonight, Hurricane Milton is now moving away from the Florida coast after making a direct hit as a Category 3 system. Its force triggered tornadoes and flooding with multiple deaths confirmed. More than 3 million homes and businesses have lost power, and as Floridians wake, they are told extreme conditions are easing, but the threat is not.
As night falls, Category 3 Milton slams into Florida's coast. Millions now without power.
Oh, there it was! Crazy!
Lashed by winds of up to 200 kilometres an hour. Its ferocity created waves the height of a two-storey building and whipped up a record number of tornado warnings in Florida, one striking a sheriff's station.
And this community was hit from what the Dopplers are showing. We got hit the hardest, the quickest.
Researching hurricanes is not for the faint-hearted. This team flying into the hurricane to collect data. Lightning was captured from space while on the ground. The man affectionately named Lieutenant Dan, who went viral for wanting to stay on his boat, had a wild ride.
Was it as bad as you thought?
No.
Australian woman Paula Hodge is in the thick of a 1-in-1,000-year rainfall event in St. Petersburg. She runs Crikey Wildlife Rescue.
Stay safe, babies.
And is sheltering 56 animals in her home.
I have chinchillas, I have a boa constrictor, a bearded dragon.
I have to just batten down the hatches and hope to the universe that your roof's going to stay on.
The roof of this once enclosed baseball field was ripped off, now an open-air stadium. It had been set up with 10,000 beds for emergency workers, while hundreds of homes now look like this.
This happened like instantaneously, like these windows blew out.
With salvage crews still cleaning up the mess of Hurricane Helene's destruction 2 weeks ago, Floridians are again left to pick up the pieces. Sarah Navin for 10 News First.
Within hours, Israel's security cabinet will meet to vote on how it retaliates to last week's missile barrage from Iran. Israeli media are reporting all preparations have been put in place, only requiring a sign-off. It comes after a phone call between Benjamin Netanyahu and US President Joe Biden, in which Biden stressed the response should be proportional. It comes as Israel's defense minister warns the retaliation will be lethal and surprising.
Our attack will be lethal, precise, and above all, surprising. They will not understand what happened and how it happened. They will see the results.
It comes as Israel launches further strikes into Lebanon with more than 1,500 people killed over the past few weeks. Rafael Nadal has called time on his remarkable career, making the announcement in Spanish on social media tonight.
Hola a todos. Estoy aquí para comunicaros que me retiro del tenis profesional.
The 38-year-old, 22-time Grand Slam winner, told fans the past 2 years have been difficult and he's been playing with limitations. The King of Clay will make his final professional appearance for Spain at November's Davis Cup Finals in Malaga. Allegations of bullying have again hit our federal parliament. The former Chief of Staff to Deputy Prime Minister Richard Marles today took the extraordinary step of holding a press conference to say she was being bullied out of a job. Political reporter Chloe Boris joins me now. And Chloe, these are serious allegations.
They are, and it's not every day you see a politician's chief of staff call their own press conference in Parliament House, but that's what happened today. Joe Tanoski telling journalists it was on a plane after an official visit to Ukraine in April that she raised concerns with Richard Marles about bullying behaviour, not by him, by staff in their office. After they got back to Australia, she claims he told her to look for another job and take leave immediately. Now, she is still on the books, but has been sidelined from her senior position, claiming she's been blocked from entering her office without giving 24 hours notice. She says the situation's led to panic attacks and suicidal thoughts. A lawyer was with her today, insisting they want accountability but aren't anticipating litigation.
I am talking about some of the most powerful people in the country who are able to close ranks, casually dismiss my story, smear and background against me, and put their own political survival ahead of any concern for the truth or my well-being.
I feel deeply sad that events have got to where they have. This is obviously very difficult. Now, let me say that in the way in which I've tried to manage this, I have done so with Joe's welfare in mind at every moment, as I would try to manage things on that basis for all of my staff.
They haven't spoken in months. His office says a number of the assertions are contested. Anthony Albanese has been made aware of the allegations, and considering he's overseas right now, the bombshell allegations have been made while Richard Marles is acting Prime Minister.
Thank you, Chloe. An Air Force pilot from Queensland has been charged with murdering his wife. Squadron leader Robert Crawford was arrested today at the family home in the Lockyer Valley. He's accused of killing his 49-year-old wife Frances, a psychologist and the mother of their three children. Crawford called police in the early hours of a July morning after he says he discovered his wife dead near a lawnmower. It had since been revealed the Defence Force aviator was leading a secret life with lovers around the world. He will appear in court tomorrow. A Melbourne woman is fighting for her life after being viciously attacked by dogs. Police were forced to shoot the dogs after capsicum spray failed to stop the three animals from mauling her. Sam Mills joins us from Melbourne. And Sam, what's the latest?
Ursula, she remains at Dandenong Hospital, where she underwent surgery following significant injuries sustained during the horrifying attack this afternoon. Now, police were called to the Dandenong home just before 10 a.m. to find the woman being mauled by a pit bull and two bulldogs. They deployed capsicum spray, but when that didn't work, fired at least 15 shots, killing all three animals. Some neighbours rushed to help, throwing objects at the dogs, desperately trying to stop the attack, with several neighbours telling 10 News First they've reported the dogs to council in the past for their aggressive nature. Now, Ursula, a police investigation is underway and Dandenong Council says they'll cooperate with that investigation.
Thank you, Sam. A man had been drinking when he stole a helicopter and did a hot lap above a major Australian tourist centre before crashing into a luxury Cairns hotel. The Australian Transport Safety Bureau today revealed we may never know why he decided to take the helicopter.
Blink and you'd miss it. The final flight of a stolen helicopter, seconds before it crashed into a luxury hotel on the Cairns Esplanade.
It was most likely inverted, and that's because of some of the damage that was done to the building, some of the lack of damage to, particularly to the skids of the helicopter, and the rotor blade impact marks into the hotel rooms.
The pilot, Blake Wilson, had been drinking with friends the night before, celebrating an informal send-off for the 23-year-old who was due to start a new job on Horn Island with the company the day of the crash. Instead, the ATSB has found he made his way to the Cairns airport after 1:30 on August 12th, punched in a security code and stole a helicopter from his employer, flying over his apartment into the Cairns wharf and back past his home a second time. At no point did the flight go over 150 metres altitude, less than half what air safety regulations require, a toxicology report showing high levels of alcohol in his system. The ATSB also found Nautilus routinely left keys in helicopters against the North Queensland Airport's transport security program, while Blake Wilson did hold a commercial pilot license and had experience, he was not approved to fly at any time and didn't have qualifications to fly at night.
We do know that the pilot did take significant measures to conceal the nature of their flight, and there is a distance of around 1.3 kilometres on a drizzly night between the air traffic controller and where this pilot took off from.
The strobe lights turned off, hiding his departure. A deliberate act, one which leaves an important question that may never be answered. Why? Pippa Sheehan for 10 News First.
Well, stay with us. Up next, Albo's huge update for Aussie exporters. Our reporter is travelling with the PM in Laos and will bring us the latest from his meeting with China's Premier. Britain's Conservative Party is voting for its next leader, so who are the top Tory picks? A bowler's million-dollar mistake, or was it the ultimate payback? We'll let you decide. That's next. Welcome back. The PM has secured a huge diplomatic win on the sidelines of the ASEAN summit as crucial talks get underway with regional counterparts. Let's go to federal political reporter Lucy Gray in Laos. And Lucy, what has he said this evening?
Anthony Albanese has used a speech to 10 ASEAN leaders here in Laos this evening to highlight the importance of deepening security and trade ties. Security talks are especially timely at this stage as China increases its maritime aggression in the Indo-Pacific, targeting countries like the Philippines in the South China Sea. On trade, Australia's relationship with the region is severely underdone. When you compare it to China, it's a small fraction of China's investment, and the importance of increasing that investment and diversifying the trade market in the region is crucial. And that cruciality and the important nature and how quickly that needs to be done is not lost on the PM.
Australia is committed to working with all of you to ensure ASEAN remains at the centre of a dynamic region where stability is secured through collective responsibility and prosperity is built by shared opportunity.
This afternoon, Anthony Albanese sat down with Chinese Premier Li Qiang for the second time in less than 6 months, and they announced an import ban on Australian rock lobster to Beijing would be lifted by the year's end. A huge feat for the PM, who has consistently tried to continue talks with China to try to get these trade sanctions lifted. It's the last of $20 billion worth of impediments which have been imposed for several years now.
Thank you, Lucy. Conflict in the Middle East is having a direct impact on petrol prices here in Australia. Over a third of the world's oil comes from the Gulf region, and Treasurer Jim Chalmers confirmed today that oil prices have spiked 7% in the last week.
Obviously, we are concerned at a time when the global oil price is increasing. We don't want to see the service stations take Australian motorists for mugs.
Despite the recent jump, oil prices are still 11% lower than a year ago. 3 months after a historic election wipeout, Britain's Conservative Party is voting for its new leader, picking the person they hope will be the country's next Prime Minister. After several rounds of voting, Tory MPs have narrowed the race down to two candidates, Kemi Badenoch and Robert Jenrick. Both are considered right-wing, reflecting a push to compete with Nigel Farage's Reform UK party, whose nationalism-based platform has attracted voters. Their positions are similar to parties that have been successful across Europe, with Germany and Austria among the countries electing right-wing politicians. Badenoch has lent into divisive culture wars and wants to cull or imprison civil servants. She's got the support of the right-wing base and is considered the favourite. Meanwhile, Jenrick, who was once considered a moderate, has taken a hardline stance on immigration, arguing sending asylum seekers to Rwanda didn't go far enough. These candidates are trying to win the votes of the 170,000 party members who are older, whiter and wealthier than your average Brit. They're tasked with electing the Tories' sixth leader in just 9 years, a choice that will shape British politics for years to come. A Melbourne truckie has copped a spray from New Zealand's Defence Minister for comments he made on social media. The minister held a press conference this afternoon and called out the online hate and misogyny levelled at the captain of a Navy ship which ran aground in Samoa.
With her Navy vessel stuck on a reef in Samoa, Commander Yvonne Graham made the call to abandon ship. Soon after, the boat caught fire and sunk. The life or death decision has been widely commended, but has also led to a torrent of misogyny and homophobia online.
I'm appalled to see the comments online from these armchair admirals, people who will never have to make decisions which mean life or death for their subordinates.
This is Judith Collins, New Zealand's first female defence minister, today taking aim.
The one thing that we already know did not cause it is the gender of the ship's captain.
And she went further, tracking one down.
I took it upon myself to look up the details of one of the keyboard warriors, or the armchair admirals, as we now refer to them in my team. He's from Melbourne in Australia, commenting in a very negative way on our Royal New Zealand Navy, and particularly the women. I looked to see what else I could find about him. Well, he is someone who drives something. He drives a truck. And I think that he should keep his comments to people who drive trucks rather than to people who drive ships.
Finishing off the salvo by saying she won't stop calling out these kinds of comments. Efforts to clean up the shipwreck are ongoing, and a court of inquiry has been called to discuss the real cause of the crash. Tallulah Thompson for 10 News First.
A man who played just one game of lawn bowls at a club in Melbourne's outer east has left it a seven-figure fortune in his will. Bruce Hallman only visited the Donvale Club once in 2019 after a volunteer drove him from his nursing home. But that act of kindness was enough for him to snub the nearby Doncaster Club, of which he had been a member for 15 years.
Bruce obviously had the time of his life for the day.
Must have been a great day, I reckon. Terrific.
The club is considering putting the money towards a dome over their green, which would be named in Bruce's honour. Good on him. Well, up next, a wildlife warning in a warming world. Plus, a family's decades-long search for a missing Monet. And the new rubbish rule that has left some Aussies really worked up. Humans are driving a catastrophic decline in the planet's wildlife, and it's putting many ecosystems on the brink of collapse. A snapshot by WWF found that wildlife populations have decreased 73% over the past 50 years. The biggest losses have been recorded in Latin America, followed by Africa. But Asia and the Pacific, which includes Australia, saw species decline by 60%. The report highlights the Amazon's pink river dolphins down 60% due to mining and pollution, and the African forest elephant herds, which have dropped by at least 78%. In Australia, the northeastern population of the hawksbill turtle is expected to become extinct by 2036. Well, have you ever left your bins out for a day or two after collection in Port Adelaide? The oversight could now mean you get slapped with a hefty fine. $312 to be exact, and residents are not happy about it. Council spokespeople argue the bins left on the footpath restrict wheelchair and pram access. But as far as locals are concerned, the new legislation can get in the bin, with some even calling the changes absurd and ridiculous. How's that for trash talk? Returning to our top story now, in Hurricane Milton, which has made landfall in the US, the monster system produced tornadoes which tore through several areas, leading to multiple deaths. Weather presenter Jade Kotick explains.
Thanks, Ursula. Well, tornadoes often occur with hurricanes approaching landfall, especially in rain bands on the side of where the circulation centre is tracking. More than 130 tornado warnings were issued by the US Weather Agency before Milton made landfall, as large dark funnels formed across Florida, putting more than 12 million people at risk. Multiple powerful tornadoes were captured by onlookers, tearing off roofs, overturning vehicles and sucking debris into the air. The heat and the humidity in the atmosphere during hurricanes, along with changes in wind direction or wind shear, creates a spinning cylinder of air parallel to the ground and a strong updraft, and that spawns a tornado. Now for your capital city forecast for tomorrow, Friday, October 11. Conditions will ease in Brisbane to partly cloudy skies, a shower or two ahead for Sydney, calm conditions right across the nation's southeast under a high, plenty of sunshine in Perth while heat builds over the top end, Darwin 36.
Thanks, Jade. A family's generations-long search for a prized painting has finally come to a close. This Claude Monet pastel and other items belonging to a Jewish couple was seized by the Nazis from a Vienna storage warehouse in 1940. After 80 years of searching and a mammoth investigation, even involving the FBI, the piece was surrendered by an American couple who didn't realise it was stolen. Now the family finally has it back, but are still looking for six other artworks, including this signed original called Sen in Paris. In fact, much of the Nazis' stolen loot is still missing.
90% of what you're looking for still can't be found. So there is a lot still out there. There is a lot still out there to be found and to be returned.
You would have to be pretty sketchy to knowingly hold on to one. Well, that's all the news you need this Thursday. I'm Ursula Hager. Thank you so much for joining us on 10's Late News. We hope you have a great night.